नमस्कार, मेरा नाम आशुतोष बहुगुणा है और मैं इंडियन कंप्यूटर इमरजेंसी रिस्पांस टीम में एज ए साइंटिस्ट डी कार्यरत हूँ। इस सेशन में हम चर्चा करेंगे मालवेयर्स पे, व्हाट द मालवेयर्स आर। सो दिस सेशन इज अबाउट इंट्रोडक्शन टू द मालवेयर्स। सो लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ दिस सेशन इज द इंट्रोडक्शन टू द मालवेयर वर्ड। सो इट्स द बेसिक डेफिनेशन एंड टाइप्स ऑफ different malwares. We will see malware functionality, we will have a look on that, current affairs, current threat landscape, we will see, we will discuss the some detection and prevention steps against the malware. So what the malware is? Malware is a malicious program. It's the set of instructions that run on your computer and make your system do something that an attackers want it to do. So a malware is a piece of a software that execute on your system with a objective, with the intention specified by the attackers. So this is something unwanted for you, unwanted for a victim. So that's the malware, so malicious program. So what they can accomplish, so what the malware can do, how it can damage to the victim. It can steal the personal information, the sensitive information in your devices, maybe in your mobile, your desktop, your laptops. So it can steal the personal information. It can delete the file. It can do some click frauds. In click frauds, it can steal software serial numbers, use your computer as relay to further attack. So that can also be done by the malicious program malware. Cyber war and weapons of mass destruction. So this malware can be used for conducting the using attack on us critical information infrastructures. So that's the and for the destruction in the destruction in the critical infrastructure such as nuclear plants, power plants, oil and gas industries and finance sectors. So that's the what the malware can do. So there are categories depend upon the features, how it is executed, downloaded and different features. There are categories of malware. So you may be aware about the backdoor, Trojan horses, rootkit, virus, scareware, adware, worm. So there is a difference based on the functionality, the features they have, and the way of executions. There are different categories of a malware. So like a backdoor. So backdoor is the something, a program, malicious program, which is providing a backdoor access to the attacker. So attacker can snoop into your computer, can listen to and can capture the keystrokes, can log all the activities of your computer. So that's the backdoor control to the attacker. Trojan horses is sometimes you will find out that you installed some software, and then along with that software there is a one malicious program which is providing again a backdoor access to the attacker. So those are the Trojan horse softwares, which is having a front end. It looks like a genuine software, a software of some use, and at a backdoor it's doing a malicious activity on behalf of attackers. Then there are a virus, then there are a scareware, adware and a worm. So these are the different types of a malware. So the like we said that in a Trojan horse, a Trojan describe the class of a malware that appears to perform a desirable function, but in fact to perform undisclosed malicious function also that allow unauthorized access to the victim computer. So it performs a desirable function also, like maybe your editing software, so that it's provide that features, but in a back end it provides some undisclosed malicious functions also that allow unauthorized access to the victim's computer. So Trojan horses are the programs with hidden malicious functionality. The functionality, malicious functionality is hidden, appear to be screensavers, game or other useful program. There is a app for that, iPhone app and things like that. So those are the Trojan horse. So what the Trojan horse can do, it can do the remote administration to complete control of a victim machine. So complete control of the victim laptop or a desktop device. So it can steal the data and a file from computer. It can further conduct the distributed attacks attacks in a zombie network, such as distributed denial of service attack. So your device may participate in a distributed denial of service because it's under control of an attacker. Can Trojan horse can be used for password stealing or the audio video capture, key logging. Key logging means whatever you are kept typing, pressing the key is transferred to the attacker. Adware means pop up and providing the advertisements. Logic bomb only executed when a specific trigger condition is met. So these are the features. So worm, what is a worm? So if you see the definition, it's a self-replicated computer program, and of course it's having a malicious functionality, but it's a self-replicating, so human intervention is not required. It will replicate. You may be aware about the recent WannaCry ransomware attack. So that worm is having a worm capability also by self-replicating. So the self-replicating through the network. So one computer is compromised, it will scan and look for other victims, and then if the vulnerability is there, it will spread to that system also. So like that, it's a self-replicating behavior. So worms are a malicious program with a self-replicating behavior. So they can spread via email attachment. Sometimes you will receive an email saying that please download this software, this is of some use, visit this website. That website will download a worm to your system, LAN or a internet. So from the LAN or a internet, if system is a vulnerable, weak, and patch is not there, so worm may infect that system. So second generation of a worms automatically search for a vulnerable computer and infect them. So worm automatically search for this vulnerable computers and then compromise them. So whole internet can be infected in less than 20 minutes. So the vulnerabilities are there within a 20 minutes. It can be all the system can be infected. So worm versus virus versus Trojan horse. So virus is a code embedded in a file or a program. So viruses and Trojan horse rely on human intervention. Human intervention means you have to click somewhere, you have to download something, you have to install something. So a human intervention is required. But in case of a worms, it's a self-contained and it spread automatically. So human intervention is not required. So that's the difference. So what is a rootkit? A rootkit is a component that uses still to maintain a persistent and undetectable presence on the machine. So rootkit is a software or a malicious program that maintain a persistence backdoor persistence existence in within the compromised machine. Then there are a ransomware attack recently, you may be aware about that. What they do? So they encrypt the systems and then ask for a ransom. So examples is a Locky ransomware. Examples are a recent WannaCry, NotPetya, Petya, BadRabbit. So those are the ransomware. So what it is doing, it's asking for a ransom. So the system is locked, encrypted, and then a decryption key is required to decrypt. Otherwise, you cannot access your system. And then to decrypt that, the attackers are asking for a ransom. They are asking for it in a cryptocurrency. They are asking, you have to pay to my wallets this much amount of money, then I will give you the key. So that's the ransomware situation. They are asking for a ransom by encrypting the systems. There are a banking trojans also, like Zeus. The purpose of those trojans is to a financial gain. So what type of it could be? So banking trojans could be like a Zeus. It can infect the system and capture the keys if there is a bank net banking attempt and things like that, so that it can capture the username passwords of the victim. The malwares are also trojans, and malwares are also present in ATM and point of sale machines and the devices used for the basically the financial transactions. So in a, at a POS or ATM, if you dip your card and use your code, PIN code, so that may be captured if that device or a machine is infected from some malware, and that data is then to transfer to the attacker, and then attacker can clone and make your copy of your card, and he is having access to the code also. So then unauthorized transaction can be made by the attacker. So banking trojans means that trojan is specially focused for the with the objective to do the financial gain for attacker, financial loss for a victim. So web malware. So we have seen the how the virus can or a malware can be distributed, how it spreads. So the one way may be the email. So you are receiving in an email, and that then you clicked and downloaded something. That's the way, or you received it in a pen drive, CD drive, and then the infected drive, and then you inserted it into your system, and your system is also. The, what is the other way? The other way is the web malware. So instead of sending it through either email or through the pen drive, CD, what can be done by the attacker, what is done by the attacker is to distribute the malware through the well-known websites. So compromise the well-known websites, compromise the genuine websites, and then inject the scripts to forward the victim browser to the malicious website to download the exploit kits and malware. There is a recent cases of a currency miners. So in a currency miners, the browsers are mining, the victim browsers are mining the cryptocurrency. If you are aware of the concept of a cryptocurrency and mining, otherwise you can do in the depth study of that. So of that attack, and that how the browsers were utilized by compromising a genuine website, browsers of victims are utilized for mining the cryptocurrency. Then there is a blended hybrid threats, that's we called the blended threats. It's it contains the characteristics of all this, the viruses, worms, self-replicating trojans, malicious scripts, and we call them this blended thing. It's hard to know where to draw the line. So generally, the malicious program may have more than one features also. Point of sale malware targets the point of sale terminals in the maybe in shopping complex shops. You are aware about point of sale terminals. We are making a transaction there. We are giving our card and details here. And the POS devices are, this is a connected to the computers. So it's also vulnerable same as your desktop and a traditional computer. So POS terminal often process hundreds and thousands of transactions per day. So compromising one POS terminal. So the data is the huge data that could be harvested by the attacker, and then they can conduct the fraud. So black POS is one such example. You can see that in depth. So then there are bots and botnets. So what is a bots? The term derived from the robot. Botnet is a network of a bot. So it's a zombie computer, compromised computer, which is under control of an attacker. So bot is basically a compromised computer. Computer which is compromised by attacker, under control of an attacker by some malware. And then botnet is a network of those compromised computers. Those are known as a botnet. So recently there are Internet of Things based devices are also found to be part of a botnet. Internet of Things like a CCTV cameras, maybe refrigerator, household appliances, those all things we are connecting over the internet. So Internet of the Things, those are also compromised and turns into the bots to do the malicious activity. So that's the botnet. So botnet architecture is this. If you look at that slide, that attacker is there through command and control. Command and control is the central nerve of that botnet, and then through command and control the attacker controls the compromised zombie machines and then launch the attacks, such as a distributed denial of service attack, spamming, or for some other crime and frauds. So basically the attacker is using your compromised system for conducting all those malicious activity. So what the architecture of a command and control server is, that it could be peer-to-peer, P2P, or it could be centralized server client model. So in a server client model, The attacker is having a one CNC, and then all the compromised zombies are connecting to that centralized server. And in case of a peer-to-peer, any of this compromised machine can act as a command and control server. So that's the basically different architecture. So through the command and control server, the attacker is managing the botnet, giving command to it. So this is C2 server, command and control server. That's the heart of botnet. So the Twitter or maybe any social media website can act as a command and control. How that, hey, if I will tweet this, the compromise machine will react in this way. If I will tweet Y, the compromise machine will react on that way. And compromise machine has to listen to that command and control server for every 15 minutes for my tweet. So that's the basically the way how attacker control the command and control. So typical classification, if you see, so how the botnets are, you see star means all the zombies are there, and then they are connected to central AI. Then there are hierarchical also, there is peer-to-peer also. So in hierarchical, this first CNC is there, then under that another CNC is there, then maybe the further also the CNCs are there, and then peer-to-peer, anyone can act as a command and control. Multi-server is there, so any multiple servers, command and control is there. So the benefit is that is for the attackers is that in peer-to-peer, it's difficult to bring down the botnet. So as an investigation team and agencies are trying to bring down the botnets. So what they will do, they try to capture the command and control and bring down that command and control. It's easy to, in case of a centralized server, star topology, to bringing it down, that okay, entire botnet is done. But in case of a multiple server, hierarchical, and this peer-to-peer, it's difficult to wipe out the entire botnet. So then there are IoT botnet, as we were discussing. So ADSL router, surveillance cameras, household and industrial appliances, automobiles, are those connected devices, IoT devices are compromised and they were part of a botnet. That botnet is the Mirai botnet was there. That Mirai botnet compromised those devices. So generally how those devices are compromised are, the vendor supplied a default username password was there, or some were not properly patched, vulnerabilities were there. So those devices were compromised by attacker, and then a botnet was created. So Mirai and IoT Reaper. So I suggest you to go through the studies of Mirai and details of IoT Reaper. So those botnets were there, those IoT advanced malicious botnets were available against the internet of the things. Then there are mobile threats. We already had a problem with the computers and for the malware, and then we have a mobile malware. So mobile malware means they are targeting your mobile devices, maybe your tablets, your mobile devices. And today we have a mobile devices with capability of a computers, full computers. We can do many things. We store many information there. So mobile malware are targeting to Android devices. And they are used generally for stealing the information, or for snooping and listening and stealing credentials of the victim. So there are a certain alert on recent Android Trojan. You can visit in the website. So we used to update and release the alert and advisory on a regular basis on the Trojan and malware. And so those details are available at a certain website. So www.crt-in.org.in you can visit. So alert section or advisory section you can have a look at. So today that mostly we have seen that ransomware is of this exploiting in a wild, and bots and botnets are criminally motivated, professionally written codes are there. And still identity, passwords, DDoS attacks are conducted. So these are the problems, recent problems. So then there is Windows features are abused by the recently malware like PowerShell, WMI. So these things are exploited and abused by the attacker. that comes the fileless malware. In case of a fileless malware, this is the category, means the attack, like you can see if the command there, so everything is executed in a primary memory and no file is dropped into the system. So that's why they are called a fileless malware. So suppose a PowerShell script or something is invoked and everything executed, so detection of this malware becomes difficult. Then malware author attackers are using a technique, evasive techniques, anti-security techniques. So anti-security techniques means the malware check for presence of anti-malware engines, firewall, application content, and then behave differently, the anti-security techniques to evade the further investigation. Anti-sandbox techniques, so malware detects the if it is executing in a virtual environment, then it change the behavior or execute in a different way. Anti-analysis technique, based on the tools, it detects the malware analyst based on the tools like Process Explorer, WireShark, or some process monitoring tools if installed in the system. So then it's obfuscate to avoid the reverse engineering. So those techniques are within the malware author used to build within the malware. So what is the prevention? Prevention is the awareness, practice basic cyber security hygiene, patch the system, update your browsers, plugins, operating systems, keep it up to date, use firewall, HIDS, host based intrusion detection system, antivirus solution, anti-malware, and scan using the keep it updated and scan your system and files for the any malware threat. Detection, for detection we have antivirus scanners and custom signatures we can create. So in antivirus scanners we have online and offline. Offlines are which is installed into our system. Online, such as a virus totals are there to scan for a malicious file or a document. Then there are a custom signature, indicators of a compromise, any YARA rules are used for finding out the infection, detection of the malware infection within a system or a network. So this references, you visit the certain website at Virus Alert at this website and can have a look at the recent virus alerts. So that's all for this session. Thank you.